And so you find in Genesis chapter 15, I'll start in verse 2. It says, "And Abram said, Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus? And Abraham said, Behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir. And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, This shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir. And he brought him forth abroad and said, Look now toward heaven, and tell the stars, if thou be able to number them. And he said unto him, So shall thy seed be. And he believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness." So what we have here is Abraham has this vision, and he's speaking with God, and he's essentially saying, the Lord says, you're going to be blessed, Abraham. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to bless you. You're going to have a great reward through the relationship you have with me. And Abraham basically says, but God, how are you going to bless me? How are you going to bless my descendants? I don't even have a son. The heir I have is this servant born in my house, this Eliezer of Damascus. And God says, no, that's not going to be your heir. I'm going to give you an actual heir, a true son that you're actually going to naturally birth with Sarah, your wife. And you're going to have a great multitude of descendants, and they're going to be a blessed people. And so that's, at the surface level, that's the situation that sets up this context. Abraham's looking to the Lord. He doesn't have any children, and he's looking to the Lord for a promised seed. And Abraham is old at this point. I want to go to, actually, the book of Romans to see a quick summary of kind of, Paul just summarizes this section and kind of Abraham's thoughts really well. So in the book of Romans chapter 4, let's read in verse 17. It says, "As it is written, I have him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead and calleth those things which be not as though they were." This is all speaking about Abraham, who against hope believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to that which was spoken, so shall thy seed be. That's what we just read. It says, "And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully persuaded that what he had promised he was able to also perform." So Abraham is about 100 years old. Him and Sarah are past the age when they can have children, and Sarah was never able to have children. So it's this kind of figure of God's essentially promising a miracle here, that they could have children when both of them are way too old for that to be possible. For many scientific means, we would say the probability of that happening is 0%. There's no way that can happen naturally. But Abraham had faith in God. When you serve a God that's all-powerful, things outside of the naturally possible can occur. Impossible things can occur because he's capable of anything. He's omnipotent. He created the universe, and so he can certainly give an offspring where it wouldn't naturally be possible. So that's kind of the context of Abraham, what he's coming into this situation with. He's already listed in the Hall of Faith for this, that God said, you're going to have a son. And Abraham said, well, that's not possible, but okay, God, I guess I believe you. I wholeheartedly believe you. And God did deliver. And I think that's important to realize when we come to Genesis chapter 22 and the story of Abraham and Isaac, because this is specifically a trial of Abraham's faith. It's kind of to test him, to prove him. And I think that Abraham may not have passed this test if he hadn't already seen what God had done for him experientially, if he hadn't already trusted in him and seen the promise was fulfilled. So we pick it up in verse 2 here in Genesis chapter 22. This is where the commandment comes from God. He says, "Take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering upon one of the mountains, which I will tell thee of." So now you have an issue. You have a promise of God that Abraham has received, and this promise is that he would have a great multitude of descendants and that they would be a blessed people of the Lord. And then you have a commandment, very real, very pressing, kill your only offspring. Right. So those are at complete conflict with one another. They can't, as far as natural things go, that's not possible. If you're expecting to have, you know, a great lineage through your only son, you certainly can't kill your only son and expect that to happen. It's not going to work that way. But once again, Abraham has great faith, and this is kind of why he's held up in the New Testament as the example or the father or the patriarch of faith. Abraham goes through with it. He takes his son up to the mountain and is fully willing to obey the commandment of God. He doesn't understand all the details, but he says, God told me to do this, so I understand it. I'm going to follow through. I'm going to go ahead with it. And so he takes him up to the mountain, and he goes through with it. He proceeds to, well, he lays the wood on Isaac, his son, and they go up to the mountain, and he pulls back the knife, and he's ready, and the Lord stops him. And he tells him, stop, and, you know, behold the ram in the thicket. And we already talked about how that's certainly a picture of the kind of substitutionary sacrifice, that something stood in place of the Lord's people. We've already looked at it through that lens. But this morning, I want to kind of really consider this story through the lens of Abraham's faith, the example of Abraham's faith here. So Abraham receives a blessing as a result of this. In verse 17, following this whole event where the Lord basically says, well done, Abraham, you followed my commandment. You were faithful. He says, the angel of the Lord says in verse 16, by myself have I sworn, saith the Lord, for because thou hast done this thing and hast not withheld thy son, thine only son, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven and as the sand which is upon the seashore. And thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies, and in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice. So he receives this blessing, this promise of more blessing upon his seed, that through your seed all of the nations of the world will be blessed. And there's a little bit more detail given in Hebrews 11. This is actually the Hall of Faith account of Abraham's actions here. So in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 17, it says, by faith Abraham, when he was tried, offered up Isaac, and he that had received the promises offered up his only begotten son, of whom it is said that in Isaac shall thy seed be called. So it lays out the conflict here. He's called to offer up his son, and yet he's trusting that the promise is through Isaac, accounting that God was able to raise him up, even from the dead, from whence also he received him in a figure. So the idea here is, or the point that I'd like to make, is when Abraham went into this, he was not acting irrationally. He was not being unreasonable in this willingness to murder his son. That's not what this was. This was faith, and it was reasonable. That's kind of the point here, is because it says Abraham went into this saying, I don't see naturally how this promise and this commandment can work. I don't naturally see that. Without God, that's not possible. But God's in the situation. So Abraham's saying, I already received my son essentially from the dead, figuratively. I mean, there was no way he could have been born, and I already received that promise. God promised it, and it was fulfilled. And so I trust that he's going to continue to fulfill that promise, that if I kill Isaac, or if someone else kills Isaac, this omnipotent God's just going to raise him up from the dead, because he's got to fulfill his promise. God cannot lie. He cannot reject himself or deny himself or fail to fulfill a promise that he's given. He's an omnipotent God, and he does not fail. And thank God that he is. We're thankful for the promises he's given us. We can put our faith in that same God, that if he promises something to us, we can bank on it. That's more reliable than, you know, something naturally. You might think, well, you know, the sun's going to rise tomorrow, as it always has. And it might. But that's technically even, you know, that might be harder to believe in technically than God, if you really think about it. If God, who created the whole universe, he's more valid to put all your trust in than some natural event, some natural phenomena that you might get used to expecting. And so that's kind of the point. Abraham didn't go into this essentially throwing his brain out the window and caution to the wind. He said, I don't see this, how this is going to work with my own eyes. But I know that God is capable to do it. And that's a reasonable thing to know. And we're in that same place today. You know, it's kind of, I guess the kind of practical application is there's things today that we don't fully understand. We don't fully understand a whole lot of social interactions and how society needs to work and how our lives are going to go and how we need to act in every situation. But if God's promised us something and he's given us a commandment, it's worthwhile to put our faith in, I don't know how to do this, God, but I'm going to do it your way. Either way, I'm going to do it your way, because you're a faithful God. You've told me how to do it. It's clear to me in your word. You've given me your word. So I'm just going to obey, and I'm going to let, you know, you kind of handle the rest. I'm just going to obey and just simply say I'm a servant of God, and kind of approach all things in life that way and through the eye of faith, which, again, is not this. I think it's something that people kind of critique Christianity for, is they say we kind of put our emphasis on this whimsical kind of wishful faith, where it's just kind of, I want something, so if I just, you know, through faith believe God will give it to me enough, then he'll give it to me. That's not the picture of faith here. Right. We have a promise of that God gave to Abraham, and we have a commandment that God gave to Abraham. None of these things were really, I mean, I'm sure Abraham wanted a lineage. I'm sure he wanted a son, I'm sure. But these are things that he had from God, and so he trusted in it. So I at least in my experience, I haven't heard the audible voice of God commanding me to do anything crazy. Maybe there are cases where that's happened throughout human history besides just Abraham and other times in Scripture. But one of the things we do have is his word. We do have his word, and we can study it, and we can see what is his commandment for us for whatever season we're in. And certainly one of the greatest overarching commandments is just that the point of our life is to fear God and keep his commandments. So we're to look to this word and kind of live by faith that way, to say, even though I want to do this, this looks like the best door for me. God's really saying, well, this is my way. If you do it my way, you'll be blessed. And that's always true. If we do it the Lord's way, we'll receive a blessing for it. And I'd like to make one more comment kind of regarding, let me go back to Genesis 22. This promise that he receives, it's really interesting here. Starting in verse 17 of chapter 22, it says that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply thy seed as the stars of the heaven, and as the sand which is upon the seashore. And thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies, and in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice. It doesn't say it expressly in the text, but it's my understanding or interpretation that this is a greater application than just the natural descendants of Abraham. Abraham is mentioned in the New Testament as kind of the father of faith. In that Romans 4 passage we looked at, section of it, he kind of lifts Abraham up as the father of faith, that this example is meant to, he's kind of the father of all of us, even though we're technically Gentiles, right? We're a Gentile nation, we're not Jews, but Abraham, in a sense, is still our father through this example that the scripture paints. And so I think that this promise of the seed is greater than just the Israelites, just the people of the Jewish religion. I think it's applied to all of the family of God. And specifically, I think that this seed that possesses the gate of his enemies and the seed that through all the nations of the earth will be blessed, I think that's specifically talking about Jesus Christ. Right. I mean, he came of the seed of Abraham. It came of David and then through Jacob and Isaac and Abraham all the way up. So he does come of the line of Abraham, and certainly it's through Jesus Christ that all the nations of the world are blessed, right? It's not just by the natural Israel that all of the world is blessed, even before Israel existed. It's through Jesus Christ and what he did on the cross. And back in Genesis chapter 3, just to kind of reinforce this idea, Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, this is going back to the garden. Right after the fall, this is God's curse upon the serpent, upon Satan. He says, I will put enmity, this is verse 15, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. So oftentimes in Christianity, this is kind of considered the first hint or foreshadow of the gospel message, right? This is the promise that God's technically giving in this curse to Satan, that you're going to lose, Satan. The seed, there's going to be one that comes of the seed of man, the son of man, born of a woman, technically, as Jesus was. And it's going to crush your head. He's going to crush your head, even though you're going to bite his heel. That's kind of the first foreshadow of the gospel message, that though this wicked world did crucify the Savior, which again was planned from the beginning, God knew that would happen, that wasn't him losing, he crushes the head of death. And he crushes the head of Satan. And I've really been enjoying this series we've been going through Luke. And it's kind of anticipation every week has been kind of growing as we get towards Friday. But I'm looking forward to hearing that victory message again. I'm looking forward to getting to Calvary one more time. So I thank you for your kind attention. I hope this has been a blessing to you.